of operation. You go to the 28th chapter of Acts. We picked it up at verse 17. Now we're going to pick it up in verse 23. All right. And so we're going to read it, if you will, please. Verse 23.
And when they had appointed him a day, there came many to him and to his lodging, to whom he expounded and testified the kingdom of God, pursuing them concerning Jesus, both of the law of Moses and out of the prophets, from morning to evening.
Yeah, he was persuading concerning Jesus out of the what?
The law of Moses
and out of the prophets. That's all he had. That's all he had to work with. He said, Moses told you about Jesus, about this Messiah. All the prophets told you about this Messiah. He's the central part of your history. This man that I'm talking about who was raised from the dead, he's the central part of your existence. You got to believe in him. And Jews, what are you talking about? Someone raised from the dead? Whoever said that? What prophet said that? And then he'll go all the way back and said, for Moses. Moses talked about, Moses. Now I can get a dame going in here today and I can say, point out to me in Genesis where Moses talked about Jesus. And we will miss it. Where are you going, Brother Travis?
In Genesis. Amen.
Hear me, the first instance, who wrote Genesis? Moses. First five books in the Bible written by who? Moses. Then where did Moses, because you ain't got no New Testament not allowed in the class, and they used the New Testament to point out Jesus. So where did Moses point out Jesus? Hello, Brother John.
Enlighten us, John.
The first instance.
3:16,
maybe.
15. Now, enmity between thee and the woman. Between thy seed and her seed, he shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel.
Yeah. He's talking about Jesus. You say, what seed?
Thy seed.
Yeah. And then Isaiah says, behold, what did he say? What did Isaiah say? Unto us, say what?
A child is born. Yeah.
They're talking about the same God. They're talking about the same God. So why do we study the Old Testament? Just to get the prophecies, the things that point to Jesus. They don't study the Old Testament to see how long Shirley's skirt can be. Or her sleeves, and all her high heels can be, and how much makeup she can wear. And all the do's and the don'ts of the Old Testament. We've studied the Old Testament to study the prophets to see how they pointed out that this is Messiah. This is how he's going to come. This is how he's going to appear. And if you just for your studying and for kicks and giggles, the first chapters of what we call the four Gospels, the first chapters of those Gospels point out all of this. First two, three chapters. You can't get about the first two or three chapters of St. John, Luke, especially Matthew, laying it all out. He said, this is how we get to Jesus. So, Moses, so this is what he said now.
Brother Daniel, I'm sorry.
Okay, go ahead.
I'm having a problem making this connection. Okay. Genesis 3:15.
Let me get there. You go ahead and read it to me then, brother.
Okay, that's what Sister Candy just read. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Okay. All right, I'm just having trouble just linking that to how that's referencing Jesus.
Okay, all right. Okay. then he says in verse 15, I will put enmity, I will put war between thee and the woman. Now, who was he talking to when he said that? Who was God talking to?
Satan.
He's talking to Satan. Look at verse 14, he's talking to Satan. I'm going to put war between you and the woman, and between your seed, which he says thy seed, and whose seed?
Her seed.
Her seed. All right, now, when would a woman ever have a seed?
When she's pregnant.
When she's pregnant.
Right.
When she's pregnant.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And she has to get that seed from who?
From man.
Okay. Where did Mary get her seed?
She got it from God.
Okay. We never heard of a woman having what? A seed.
Right.
And that would, that, so that, if they would, if they was jumping around hanging off the chandeliers and stuff like that, they would have missed that. When he said, her seed.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Her seed. Because if he was intending on it, that seed to be a man, he would say between your seed and his seed, planted in woman. He didn't say that. He said between your seed and her seed. And we say, her seed. Her seed. What woman is walking around here with the ability to create life? It's got to be from a man. Oh, he said, her seed. And since God said it, everybody would say, I don't know what he's talking about, but he said, her seed. So,
and the reference scripture is Isaiah 7:14.
Isaiah 7:14, okay, strengthens that a little bit. Okay, what's
therefore,
it say?
The Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel.
A virgin shall get pregnant. And he said, with her own seed. Luke and them says, that was the Holy Ghost doing it. So the Holy Ghost implanted a seed into a virgin, which we call Mary. And that seed and the devil's seed is constantly at war, but this one is going to be a big battle. That's why he said enmity between your seed and your seed. It's going to be a fight. Now, in order for that fight to occur and to be finalized, that seed and that woman is going to have to die and go down. This fast forward is going to hit them, have to die and go down into the seed of the devil's headquarters and do battle. And that's where Jesus says in Matthew 28:16, behold, I got all the power. How'd you get it? I worked it out. He said, look, I got, that's what behold, look, I got all the power. How'd you get that power? Paul says, I'm learning this, Paul says, by revelation, and then he goes into his writings in the book of Ephesians, and he says, not only did he go up into heaven, but he first went down into hell.
Mm-hmm.
And when he went down into hell, that's when Jesus defeated the devil and got all the power. And he brought back on earth and says, look, I got all the power. He said, I got it all. But that enmity, that battle that he talked about right there, was Moses saying it, but nobody getting an understanding of it until Paul takes all day long just using using the prophets and Moses' writing to explain to people. And they just, some of them get it, some of them ain't. See what I'm saying? So that's what verse 15 is about. Her seed would be talking about Mary getting pregnant. God said a long time, I'm gonna straighten this out. I'm gonna have me a virgin. It's gonna bring my son's gonna come through, virgin birth. Why was it like that? Her seed, not his seed. Why was it not just another man implanting a seed into Mary? Because man's seed, Adam, is what? Messed up.
Mm-hmm.
Can't use Adam stuff no more. Everything after Adam, through Adam, out is messed up. I got to have a new flesh and blood down here, humanity, walking on the earth, not touched by Adam's seed. Because Adam's seed is now in transgression. I gotta have me a man that's not out of Adam. Let's go get some Krispy Kreme donuts.
That's a deep sentence, you know. I never really.
Yeah. See.
I never really looked at that.
Yeah.
I never even looked at that.
I gotta have me a man, not from Adam. Now, so the first Adam done away with. Second Adam, that's us. Because we come through Christ. And that's what he says in the book of Galatians. That now, although you were Gentile, and you didn't come through that natural seed that Jesus had come through, that Holy Ghost seed, and all everything forward, it's going to be a natural seed now, but Jews. Now, how about us Gentiles? How we get in on this thing? And that's one thing that trips up the Jews even right now. I don't see how they get in, because Moses didn't say nothing about others. How do they get there? So this is what Paul's going to bring out here. Just, that kind of cleared up for you?
Yeah, that did. Thank you.
Okay. All right. So here's first thing he did, chapter 28, verse 23, persuading Jews first concerning Jesus out of the law of Moses and of the prophets. From morning to evening, that's all he's got. The law of Moses and the prophets. And then some got it, verse 24, and some did not. Verse 25, and when they agreed not among themselves, they departed after that Paul had spoken one word. And this is what Paul had to say about them leaving, not in full agreement. Well, that the prophet says, now what the prophet spoke is being evident. And that when he's talking about Isaiah 6 and what was that?
9.
He's talking about Isaiah 6 and 9, that the prophet had it right. You're going to hear, but you're not going to understand. That's what he's saying in verse 26. Saying, go unto this people and say, hearing, you should hear and should not understand. And seeing, you should see and not perceive. So you're going to see, you're going to hear, and you're going to see about the grace of our Lord. And that grace of our Lord, you see the miracles? You see people coming to Christ? You hear people speaking in tongues that filled with the Holy Ghost? You see and you hear all that, but you don't get it still. Now, how many people do we have today that see all that and know what?
Don't get it.
What in the world? Some folks have heard of that church as crazy as anything. Speaking in tongues, waving their hands, singing in tongues. Well, who ever heard of it? Who was that? That's crazy. What's the people that you hear today? Seeing and hearing, and they still don't believe. So Paul says, well, was the prophet right? And he says, that's what's going to be going on. So, and so Paul is he's getting kind of fed up with it. Remember, he's been preaching all day. And then verse 27, what did he say?
Well, the heart of this people is waxed gross. Their ears are dull of hearing. Mm-hmm. Their eyes have they closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart. It should be converted. I should heal them.
And I should heal them. So God says, I would have healed all of them that came to believe. All right. So this is, they have reached, as far as Paul the Apostle is concerned, they have reached their limit with him. Who? His people. How many of you got tired of us? I don't live next to him no more. I don't go to the same grocery store with him no more. I'm through with him. They're stealing my car, breaking in my house, they're doing all kind of unrighteous. I'm through with him. This is what Paul is getting to. Pray for them. And it take all day to tell them something, and they still don't do it. As much as he is a man of God and everything, he's had his fall. Even nobody else know to get like that.
Yep.
Even my own kin folks.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
tell them. What are you going to do? Just keep worrying with them? Stand up late? Bother them? Call me anytime you have a problem. I'll get up and pray for you. That's what Shirley does. Just call me, hot child. I'll pray for you. When you get in jail, call me 3 in the morning. I'll pray for you. Come on. I love you. You're my people.
Yeah.
Brother Williams would say, bail bonds been open up at.
They always open.
They always open at
that. Your money ready.
You're disturbing my sleep. When I wake up in the morning, if I can remember you, I will pray for you. Romans 11 chapter, verse 3. I'm bored that you get to be a preacher. Oh. Okay, we're going to go with Romans 11. I hope you're there. Okay, look with 11 and verse 5 before we get down to verse 8. Verse 5. Even so then, at this present time also, there is a small amount, a remnant according to the election of grace. Now, what that means is that even at this time, Jews are coming into faith. And they are welcomed in to the family of Jesus Christ through faith, separated from the Israeli nation. From Israel as a people. They come in as a, you might be a nationality as a Jew, but you don't come in with all the rights and privileges that you have as a nation, as a person of Israel. You come in as just an individual being saved by grace. Believe me or not, believe me, that's different than if they would have came in as a nation. We said that at another time. Okay, verse 6. And if, see that you're in now, how?
By
grace. Verse 6, you're in now by grace. This is it, no more what?
Works.
No more in the Moses stuff, but you're in by grace. If a Jew get in, he's in by grace. Separated from anything that Moses ever said to him about the tabernacle, the showbread, and the Sabbath day, and all this and all that. Otherwise, grace is what?
No more grace.
You're in strictly on grace. But if it be of works, then it is no more grace. Otherwise, work is
no more work.
So he says it's all grace. He's better now. What then? Israel had not what? Obtained that which he what? Is looking for. Israel as a nation. Jewish people as a nation has not found their Messiah. But the election, those that had that come in under grace, a Jew coming in under grace, he has found his Messiah. But the rest of the Jewish nations were what? But Jewish people are what?
Blind.
The majority of Jewish people are what? Blind. I'm saying that on YouTube, brother. Word said it, see? According as it is written, what did God do with that Jewish majority? Israeli majority.
Giving them the spirit of slumber.
Giving them a spirit of slumber.
Eyes that they should not see, and ears that they should not hear unto this day.
Until this day. This day. Okay, and then verse 9, what did he say there? David says, let their table be made what?
A snare.
And a trap. And a stumbling
block.
That's to pay him back for not believing in the Messiah that has come. And you see all of that. You see all of that. Verse 11. What do you say, Candy?
Thank you.
Verse 11. I say then, how they stumbled that they should fall. We're talking about the Jewish people. How they stumbled that they should fall. He says what?
God forbid.
See, it's bad. And we read about stories how God rescued Israel all the time back in the day. You know, he rescued them and they turned away. They got in trouble. Said he rescued them again. Then he says, is he going to rescue them again? He says, yep. God's going to rescue them again. Right now, they're in deep trouble. You just see, if you listen to the news, they can't sleep unless they got a bunker or something. Hiding. There's just stuff happening all the time.
They
try to wipe them off the face of the earth. Israel, as in if the Palestinians get their way, our day is made when we wipe them from the face of the earth. Little bitty old nation over there, but they can't. How come they can't wipe them out? God's got his head on them, protecting them still, even though they're in unbelief, protecting them still, because that was the apple of his eye.
Yeah.
And it still is the apple of his eye as a nation, but he says, stumbling block right now. Okay, so now God forbid whether, so verse 11, God forbid rather through their fall, salvation is come to who? The Gentiles. To do what?
To provoke them,
to make them mad and get jealous. God said, see me working in the lives of these who, Gentiles? That's what I would have been doing through you. Okay. Now if the fall of them be the riches of the world, and the diminishing of them the riches of the Gentile, how much more their what? Fullness. If they'd have stayed with God, and when they get back with God, just watch where they want to go.
What's going to happen?
Watch. So, now we'll go back to our lesson again. Probably come back to Romans 11. Our lesson verse 28. Be it known therefore unto you that the salvation of God is sent to the Gentiles, and they will what? Hear it. The salvation of God is sent to the Gentiles, and they will hear it. And when he had said these words, the Jews departed. Can you imagine in your house? And you're there hearing the word of your elder, your patriarch. And he's saying to you, you've been so bad, and you won't turn around, I'm kicking you out. Get out. Even over the holiday season.
Get out.
Can't come back from college, what have you. The patriarch is saying, get out of the family. How would you feel? Would you feel like fighting? Especially if your older sibling or sibling delivered that news to you instead of the patriarch. You kicked out the will. You out, I'm in. You out, and because you've been so bad, you just kicked. How would that make you feel? You'd be kind of mad and upset. Brother did the car, and he ain't buying you no car. I'm buying me a car. I'm getting a new car. He put some money in my account, ain't putting nothing in your account. He's paying for my college, ain't paying for your college. Taking care of my loans, ain't people. So that's how the Jews was feeling then. First they couldn't believe it, then they got mad. Wait a minute, I'm a Jew, you can't, wait a minute, I'm part of the family. You know, that's what they're saying about Paul, that's how they're feeling about, I ain't quite sure I'm getting this with you, Paul, what do you think? So it's a little bit of a
rivalry, madness, upset, fighting going on here. And
they departed, verse 29, they departed, and great reasoning among themselves, and they thought this over. Now, say, sure, how come you didn't pay attention when Moses was speaking? Who was you when Isaiah said that? Did you get that? What you always say? I didn't get it. I was hanging out chin. I was in the spirit. Brother, did you hear Isaiah say anything like that? Did you get that from Moses right now? Some of them said, I could see it, but I didn't know. And then he says, and Gentiles are there?
But all races now consider Gentiles.
All races. Anything that's not a Jew. Okay. Anything that's not a Jew.
So that stands over in Gaza, so they can still
there. Gentiles.
So they get to be born.
Yeah, Gentiles. Anybody that's not of Israel, not of Abraham's seed, a branch, is Gentiles.
You know, this is a great example of how people depend on others to tell them what they should think or what they should know.
Right.
You know, just using these examples here.
Right. It's just a few people, like we read about Jesus' auntie. Who's that? Elizabeth. Elizabeth, and then Mary, his mother. They were cousins. And you got John. You got John's father, Zachariah. And you got. You know, just a few, a remnant of people. And who was that? Ananias in the temple who said he prayed until he stayed alive until he could see that seed being born. Simon, until he could see that seed being born, and he just says, now I'm ready to die. I seen that prophecy. I stayed alive to see that prophecy. And so many of them, some of them got it, many of them didn't get it. The ones that got it hung on to it. And they said, here it is, right here. Here it is. So, it's a matter of believing. It's a matter of getting in that heart and believing it. They said, I got it, I believe it. I can see it happening. I can see it. But most folks, head knowledge and heart faith is two different things. Your head can see one thing, and your heart can see it, can see one thing and see it totally different from the heart. So Paul, and then here's Paul with all this uproar. He dwelt two whole years in his own hired house, and received all that came unto him. So in other words, he had some leniency there from the prison. So generally, traditionally, that when you're a prisoner, you're always chained to one of the soldiers. Yeah. I'm kind of thinking that he wasn't even chained. They kept an eye on him, but he was free to move around and do it as he pleased. Because one, they couldn't find anything to convict him of. And certainly, whatever the evidence was, it wasn't worthy of them killing him. So that he was in a quandary because, what are we going to do? Well, the Jews are always bringing up accusations against him, so he's always in court. And when he did come get out and Rome about, someone was lying on him, telling him this and that and that. And he says, and then the Romans will have to get him and say, well, what's... We don't see nothing to put him to death about, but they did. He said, we don't see. So, if you look back on it, probably was a degree of protection for him. Because the Jews weren't going to break through those Roman soldiers to get to him, and he's there. So, sometimes circumstances you find yourself in make you think that, man, this is the worst of the worst. I'm in the worst spot I could be in my life. But you know what? If you don't know, God probably has got a hand or shadow over you saying, no, this is the best place for you to be. May not look like that to the naked eye, but no, I got you right here. So let's see how Paul felt about his imprisonment. I thought I had it. Let's look at, I'll see what I can get. He wrote to Philemon and Philippians, and he said some things. Look at Philippians 1, first chapter, verse 20. How you feel. Now, Paul, he had the expectation that he was going to get free. He's going to eventually get let loose. But this is what he said. According to my earnest expectation and my hope, that in nothing I should be ashamed, that with all boldness as always, so now also Christ should be magnified in my body, whether it be by life all by death. And that's where he came up. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. He wrote this letter to the Philippians while he was in jail. So he says, my earnest expectation and hope. And then he says, well, whether they kill me or not, for me to live is Christ, for me to die is gain. You see his total commitment. Look at Philemon, first chapter, verse 22. Says in verse 22 that but whether prepared me also a lodging, for I trust that through your prayers I should be given unto you. So he says, if you pray for me, I think I can be set free and I will come into you. Mm-hmm. He wrote in 2 Timothy that he was expecting to be killed. That's going to be in 2 Timothy, the 4th chapter, verse 6 through 18. Mm-hmm. 2 Timothy, he didn't know. He wasn't too sure about what was going to happen. Second chapter, 2 Timothy, the 4th chapter, verse 6. So, he's on death row. Here's his resolve on death row. I am now ready to be what? Time of my departure is what? I'm ready to die. Henceforth, what did he say, verse 8? Knowing that he's about to go. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a what?
Crown of righteousness.
Which the Lord, the righteous judge, should give me at that day. Not to me only, but to all them also that love is occurring. And he says, do thy diligence to come shortly. He says, hurry up and come see me. Because, I might be dead any day. But he says, my resolve is that I'm a doctor. He says, but if I die, it's gain. That's his mind. That's if I die, it's gain.
Yeah.
But as long as I'm living, I'm going to be preaching Christ. Now, that's a commitment.
That's a commitment.
Upside down circumstances. And then he says, verse 11, I ain't got very many friends.
Mm-hmm.
How many people coming to see me?
Only Luke is with me. Take more.
Only Luke is with me. The writer of Acts, the author of the book of Acts.
Mm-hmm.
Only Luke is with me. And I'm on death row. Ooh, man. I can imagine and feel some upside down circumstances, you know. I got arrested one day because they thought I was the wrong guy. My identity all messed up. I got into a little holding cell. I thought life had came to the complete end. I said, can I imagine this for 30 years? I said, life.
Still going on.
Yeah, I'm soaking in my own misery.
Terrible.
How many people could have passed by my way and could have used the witness?
Yeah.
Could have used the positive word. Just in that circumstances. How many prisoners? I'm thinking about getting my blood out of here. What's going on? But here's Paul. And, you know, it says, I'm ready to die. I'm on death row. He got it resolved. I'm ready to be offered up. He could have changed his testimony at any time. That's amazing. Okay, we got to get out of here. But he did get to minister to some very prominent, important people in the Caesar's household. He talked to Caesar's staff and all of his lieutenants and everybody like that, important people. Tradition is taught that somewhere that Paul was murdered, but it is not backed up by scripture. It seems to say that Paul lived in a house and taught from a house as long as he wanted to, not that he was actually executed or killed. So circumstances change some kind of way, something happens, or we don't really have definite, got to get out of here, don't really have definite feel that Paul is actually killed.